Einen wunderschönen guten Morgen. Wer von euch spricht Englisch? Ihr könnt mich aber verstehen, also kann ich ja Deutsch weiterreden. Because everybody raise your hands, you can. I say I don't have to speak English, because you all are able to understand German language. That's great. Hello and welcome at the Experience Hall. My name is Johnny Jobertai. I'm the German editorial director of Huffington Post. I'm the host of today of all of you guys. That's actually the best hall. But before we start, we do a little broadcast to a different hall where the big opening is right now, and we would like to tell everybody that they did a big mistake going to the other hall and they should come here. And I need your help in order to do that, because Christian, the guy who actually founded the DMEXCO, told me, he would call me, Chano, how are you? Are things great there? What are you doing? I said, well, you know, Christian, I will say, you know, it's kind of good here. You guys did a mistake. This hall is the best hall. And when I say this guy is the best hall, I need all of you guys to cheer up. Can you do that? Yes. I can't hear you, sorry. I think we will, no, wait a minute. We have to test it. Yeah, Christian, sorry, you know, at your hall, it's kind of great, but my hall is the best hall. Come on, have a look. That's the spirit. Thank you very much, because we have a great show here. You know, we will start at 10 a.m. with David Shing. He's a colleague of ours. He is like the chief innovation guy of AOL. He is a guy who went into Arianna Huffington's office and told her, Arianna, I love your office, but the way you styled it kind of sucked. Change the blinds. Have you heard of Mies van der Rohe, the way you have to produce the light? And Arianna said, who are you, guy? He said, my name is David Shing. I'm going to change your office. And he actually did. And that guy is talking right now here at 10 a.m., right after we do our little broadcast to the biggest hall. I forgot the name. Experience Hall, that's the thing, right? Good. Maestro, could we have some Bob Marley, please, before we start? That would be great. And please give me, you know, when I was young, I was a Metallica fan. You know, I needed loud. Where's my Bob?
Hot water, the pool is thirsty. Rat race.
A little bit more, please. Yeah.
Rat race.
That's the spirit.
Rat race.
So we are waiting rat here. Race. Just 2 minutes.
It's a disgrace to see the human race in a rat race. Rat race.
Party, we'd like to inform you guys, because this is the best hall on the DMEXCO 2016. My name is Shani Obertai. Welcome everybody. This is the best hall you can be. We'll start immediately in about 1 minute, but before we start, we are trying to do some very low tech. We are trying to do a broadcast to a different hall, which name I forgot. And now I'm really curious, will it work? Christian, are you there? Christian is not there. Christian? Christian, are you there? Because in the other hall, there's lots of famous people, lots of politicians, big wigs. They do not have the fun. The fun is here. And they said, because, you know, China, we would like to start our hall without fun. That's what we would like to broadcast here. And we use a great technology called Skype. Skype is great. I love Skype. But I don't know why it doesn't work, but it kind of doesn't work. And now I'm kind of lost. Should we wait for the guys in the other hall, or should we start? Isn't there anybody who can help me? The first person is actually leaving the hall. Lady, you can't leave. It hasn't already started yet. I look better in younger days. She wouldn't have. What a pity. Ladies and gentlemen, I think, is there anybody who can help me if we should wait for the other hall or if we shouldn't wait? Good morning! Thank you very much. Big welcome to the Experience Hall at DMEXCO 2016. This is the best hall. Ladies and gentlemen, we would like to inform you about the newest trends in digital marketing, and we thought about it very hard. How could we start? What would be like a real kick-ass start in Cologne? Cologne people love kick-ass starts. That's why we came up with a person, we looked hard. He came from very far away. He just arrived this morning at Cologne Airport. He is actually, ladies and gentlemen, the digital prophet of AOL, and he's a great guy. He's a funny guy, and he will inform you about things you wouldn't have ever thought about. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome a guy I just met. His name is David Shing.
Hey guys, morning.
Right.
Lots of questions.
Okay, sure. Far away,
dude. Hey, David, how are you doing?
I'm doing really well.
How's your jet lag?
German efficiency at its best this morning. I can see that.
Come on.
What's your question?
The question is, you know, you're a DMEXCO veteran.
Dude, by the way, you should be pushing me around. Look how big you are. Holy crap.
Yeah, well, come on. It's like life ain't fair. You know that. Come on.
Yeah.
We met you several times here at DMEXCO, you know, yep. How do you keep yourself, you keep up reinventing yourself all the time? What's your secret of success?
I don't know about reinvention, man, and I'm going to talk about a little bit about that today, because on this stage, the topic that I wanted to talk about was innovation, and I want to talk about invention. I don't know if there's a reinvention.
No, but inventing yourself, yourself personally. Look at these girls, they want to know.
The reality is this, here's how I keep in touch with things. I actually don't. My network's very, very small. I speak to people human to human, and then I do a lot of texting and I do a lot of email, and the last thing is the free web. And so from my perspective, it's all about making sure I hang out with people that are interesting and different and not in our industry.
Okay.
True story.
Good.
And not that funny, not that interesting. Sorry about that.
Oh. The place is all yours.
Thanks, man. Hey, guys. Right. Experience. Let's talk about this. Firstly, this is a pretty cool hall today, and to be thrown off this morning with the lack of Skype, which we think is an amazing product, but the fact that we haven't had German efficiency this morning makes me think about this. This is the gig. At the end of the day, there are no passengers. We are all crew, and this is Marshall McLuhan. We're in a world where you have to get things done. The reality is, as long as you've had donuts and coffee this morning, this should be okay, because we're going to spend 25 minutes together. I'm going to run pretty damn quickly, and I've decided to try and do the bulk of my presentation through emoji. So let's try this. Here's the deal. I'm going to also bridge it by talking about why, the what, and the how. And here's where we need to go. These are all of the words. If I look at the itinerary for DMEX, here's the deal. This is the discussion that everybody wants to talk about. Everyone's talking about these factors. Does anybody want me to give me a heads up what I think is the most overused word this year is going to be? Storytelling. Oh, that's awesome. Not necessarily. I think it's experience. Like this hall. I think these guys are great by heading it up early. In fact, experience is in the title of my discussion this morning, but let's get to it. Here's what I think is interesting. I've decided that innovation is out and invention is in. And people are like, well, aren't they the same thing? No, they're not the bloody same thing. Because if you think about culture today, if you think about the word that was added to the Oxford Dictionary of last year, it was tears of joy emoji. How do you find that shit? Because I thought the dictionary used to be A to Z. And where I find this to be interesting is that if you think about change, which is really what innovation's about, that's different to a creation, which is really what invention's about. And that's where I think today is where we are. And I also think that what's fascinating is that a company like AOL has gone from that to somebody who does this. We build brands that people love. How amazing is that thing? But here's what's interesting. If you think about what we've done as an organization, we've done all of this. We basically built brands that get to people that love them. HuffPost Germany is one of them. You guys know that really well. And then we get people to the brands that they love. That's what ad tech does. And both of those cannot be done unless you have a combination of culture and code and a dash of creativity. And it needs to look like this. Here's an example of all culture, no code. This is an example of all code, no culture. And we love what Google does, but this is an example of their technology not working, God bless them, because this is very important type of technology you're going to see on that floor is look up technology like glass, but it has to be a balance of both. And I decided that emoji was the best I could do, but it's really maybe this for you guys. For those of you who are German, probably don't surf that much, but maybe snowboarding is more applicable. But here's what is interesting. The most overused word of last year was not storytelling. That's the most overused word, period. But here's what's interesting. In my world, when we think about the most overused word, it was disruption. And everybody wants to disrupt. I'm like, okay, awesome. How are we going to do that? And they're like, well, let's use a combination of business and technology. I'm like, well, actually, the business model itself is the thing that needs work. Because here's the deal. Understanding human needs is half the job of fulfilling it, period. That's our gig. If you can get that right, it really starts to understand what human behaviors are about. And if you do it, we could look at psychographics, nothing like a solid psychographic quadrant, first thing in the morning on a Wednesday. Holy shit, the caffeine is not hitting in. But this is the sort of thing that people think about. They're like, who do we target as people? Okay, that's one way. Or you could think about Maslow's rule of hierarchy, which is another way of thinking about it. Both of these things are based upon human need. And what's really interesting about it is our behavior is being changed by technology. Technology is absolutely changing our behavior. It is not changing our need. Our need is rooted in the DNA of humans. That's why somebody like Channel can stand up here and be a great compere for you today, because it's connecting with your humanity. And that's what makes it really interesting. Here's an example of human connection that cannot be supported by technology. You really need physical connection, you bloody scumbags. I was checking to see if Tinder is available in Germany. Hell yeah, it is. You guys are out of control on that crap. But what I think is interesting is that when you think about the connected human, this is what becomes fascinating. People immediately go, dude, let's go with this cat. I'm like, you're going to see a lot of this in some of these exhibition halls, dude. And please don't scare those people because they're trying to have an immersive experience. God bless them. But where I find this to be interesting, if that's your future, you can have my seat. But where I find it fascinating is really the world of change. And the world of change for me is a little bit like this. You know, if we think about it, it has to be grounded upon motion. It has to be grounded upon an element of movement, like video, and it has to be grounded upon reality. And I want to talk about some of those realities. The first one is augmented, and then you have virtual, and then you clearly have real, and then we have mixed. There are four types of realities. The one I prefer most is real reality, the one we're experiencing right now, because if you think about it, these are amazing experiences. However, there's still this human connection. If we think that Google Glass is hard to, you know, to sort of associate with, maybe this is even harder. This guy couldn't give two shits about who was in the room, man. And I love that because his immersive experience was all about him. But where I find this to be fascinating is that today the arc of story is all done by a director's point of view. So if you and I go and watch a film today, here's what happens. We will get a director's point of view. If you laugh at a scene and I cry at a scene, we cannot do anything about it. But believe you me, we are headed to a place where as soon as you put these immersive experience physical hardware in play, you now have the ability to have lateral story. And potentially, you can morph into things that are completely different. Until we have the ability for technology to understand what our emotions are doing, like knowing if you laugh and I cry and changing the content, you have physical technology trying to give you much more of an experience like this. This is a cage that simulates what it feels like to be on a roller coaster. However, if you're going to have to be in a cage this big in a room that big, you might as well go on a roller coaster, but that's just me. However, you've got augmented reality. Love this. Gosh, it's come a long way. You have the ability for somebody like this young lady to try on makeup in real time, and look how beautiful and photographically real that is. I love that thinking. And if you think about virtual reality, you can blend it into actual reality. Look what Jaguar did. Check this out.
This is the Jaguar F-Type simulator. It's just sitting on a 6-axis hydraulic platform here. Roll you around, lift up, down.
How rough are we getting
there? Once you're wearing this helmet, that's really going to simulate exactly what it's going to be like on the track.
Very cool.
Make sure you brace yourself. Good luck.
Okay, Glenn, I'm about to start the ride.
Welcome to Jaguar Virtual Simulator. Ready to experience the power of Jaguar F-Type?
There is no amount of experienced reality that can make you feel that type of reality experience, and you know where that goes. However, if you look at somebody like Lockheed, Lockheed Martin recently did a simulation of virtual reality of what it feels like simulated for these kids without the goggle on. So they're all entering a shared human empathy experience of being in the same room, same place, same time, all experiencing the same thing, where they put these kids into a school bus and make them experience what it would be like if they were on Mars. So think about that as you guys are building these experiences, when you're told about experiences, how you can adapt these things to be more immersive. But one of those things that we do need to adapt to is production. And I love DMEX for this reason. It talks about how to get stuff done. And that's the world we're in today. Remember, we're no passioners. We're all absolutely crew. So production becomes really important. We have to think about how production works. Now, that's why people like Samsung are going to be here, because what they're doing, they're super smart by giving the tools to the creators, you lot, to see if you can experiment with it to create demand for the hardware that we're all going to wear. And you're going to produce content like this. This is just a simple example of somebody tying up their smartphone to a wire and heading down a ski slope and putting their camera in slow-mo. And what you're experiencing here is a beautiful piece of production quality you could not have scripted. And this is about the experimentation world of where we are today, because that's the reality of what you are as a creator. And you end up with something that you could not have experienced. Or something like this. This is beacon technology with a drone. This means that this drone will produce content without a camera person. And what you end up with is a beautiful experience that is a dynamic of some new technology helping to bring production costs down. Because the reality of production is this. Today, you're trying to produce stuff that are on multiple platforms or screens. When people talk about screen agnostic or platform agnostic, we're also talking about the category of IoT, or in fact, the category of IoE, which is the Internet of Emotions, not the Internet of Things or everything. It's emotion that we're trying to get to, and it's things like this. Beautiful product called Hello. You clip it to your pillow. It senses your sleeping patterns. It has listening technology, so it will tell you that a dog was barking and a car alarm went off. It differentiates it. This is Pacify. This is a smart pacifier that will monitor the number of times your child sucks on a pacifier and will tell you when it's starting to teethe. Crazy. Well, you got this
bloody thing. Some smartphone cases just protect your phone. Others try to extend your battery life. A few have even tried to protect you, the user. But how great would it be if there was a case so intuitive, so powerful, that it could do all three?
Introducing Yellow Jacket,
the world's first stun gun smartphone case.
Okay, if you missed that, that was the world's first stun gun phone case. So now I work for one of the largest telcos in the world. It's incredible what can happen where people are trying to adapt this to be the largest visual controller to your world. And we're wrapping things around this to the extreme of a stun gun controller. But where I find this to be fascinating, by the way, if you don't want to walk around planet Earth like everyone else with a black box in your hand, go to Asia, because they're inventing very cool shit like this. The robot phone. How cool is that thing? Woo! But then we've got this sort of technology happening.
Have you ever noticed that the world's most powerful men don't carry a wallet? In fact, have you ever seen them pay for anything? Well, now you can join them. Introducing the MJ Bail Power Suit. In collaboration with Heritage Bank and Visa Paywave, we've developed the technology to embed a contactless payment chip and antenna into the sleeve of a suit. So now you can pay invisibly wherever you go.
How about that technology? It's probably over there by PayPal, but check this thing out.
And is that
far up, yeah?
Is that right?
Yeah, yeah, that's it.
If a player is tackled, then you get to feel the physical effect of that. But if a player is nervous before a kick, then you get fluttering, you get that kind of sensory experience.
So what's happening here, guys, is that media companies are actually giving you embeddable technology in your living room. You no longer have to go to Disney World to experience what it's like to be a footballer on the field. These are the immersive experiences that are people trying to experiment with us, including brands. So take one of the largest brands on the planet, Mondelez. They own a chewing gum brand called Trident. They got together with a Japanese clothing designer and said, when you put your smart devices in the pockets, we're going to knock out your network, give you no updates, nothing, nothing, nothing. Because when you chew chewing gum, you can focus, and we're going to allow you to refocus again. That was their value proposition. So we're seeing additive technologies and subtractive technologies when people are trying to think about the arc of wearables. And here's another device which I think is crazy. This is the gaze. This is a 3D dress that will morph and change based on the way that person looks at you. You determine whether you want to attract them or distract them. Right? I'm pretty sure it doesn't make that rattlesnake sound. But I could really use that shit when I'm on the subway in New York, I can tell you that. But what I can tell you is that everything is now measuring us. And that's the beauty of this. When I speak to fitness companies, which I thought were fitness companies, they don't say they're in health or fitness. They're saying they're in the data business. They're competing against us. And so what's incredible about this is that now we've gone from something like cinema to television to smartphone to things like other devices. This is what we're having to think about as people who are delivering information based on needs, based on moments, meeting the right person, right time, right place on a different type of device. Right. But if it's grounded upon sight, sound, and motion, that's great because what it creates is emotion. And when you think about this, life has changed when I grew up in Australia. If you've been wondering about my accent, that's where I'm from. That's my family. I just thought I'd emoji the shit out of those kids. But what I think is interesting is at 17, when I bought my first car, that's when I felt freedom, independence, and self-expression. At 17. The only reason I'm a prophet, by the way, is because I was the first planker on the planet. But here's the deal. I grew up in the world of four P's, price, promotion, placement, etc. The challenge is that people still use these, man. These were invented in the 40s. The reality is they've changed to this. Partnerships, pedigree, platforms, and it's absolutely about partnerships. And this is what the world that we're doing today. And if you think of what brands have to do, in the day, this is what we used to worry about. Just this, no worries. We used to plan this and then go out and have a big fat long lunch with your media planner. Awesome. Those days are dead and buried because the average CMO has to think about just some of these places to have a brand engagement to experience a consumer today. That's the reality. And the real reality is that it turns out that 37% of children under the age of 2 can operate your swiping devices. So if you have children, this is your world. If you have children, when you give them magazines and shit, they think stuff's busted. I don't have children yet, but I love this. I could watch this all day with you guys. We should just play this for 25 minutes. How good is this thing? That's the world. But what's interesting, here's the thing. People are saying, well, I hear you talk about digital. I hear you talk about digital and physical not being any difference. Is that true? Let me explain. It is true. The younger generation, the younger adults do not see any delineation between digital currency or physical currency. So virtual currency and digital currency is the same. A digital toy or a physical toy is the same thing. A game played on a controller or a board is the same thing. They're all games. An image is the same thing. It's all about context, whether it's on Snapchat or a billboard. It's about the type of image to engage emotionally with people. But here's the deal. It's no longer about consumers consuming content. Those days are dead and buried. We now have the creator, the critic, and the curator of an experience. The slash gen, you little bastards, because you're this. You're a DJ, blogger, fashionista, ambassador, amplifier, influencer, affluencer. It's incredible the tools, empowerment, and this is what brands are competing against, people. But if you give them the tools, they create amazing stuff like this.
The building is on fire, fire. The building is on fire, fire.
I said, no, what? I got my three kids and we
This was just a regular news feature for this young animated lady, and DJ Michelle took this and said, I can turn this into a crazy remix that'll crash the internet. And this is the sort of things when the creators have the access to the tools to create contagious content. But if you're sitting there and saying, look, dude, I know that old people can produce content too, I beg to differ, because this is a piece of content produced by a guy called Joe Griffith. Joe went and had a holiday with his wife in Vegas. For an entire week, he filmed his holiday, but he forgot to turn the GoPro around. So we end up with this spectacular piece of storytelling that you could not have scripted.
Oh, what direction the Grand Canyon is, I'm not sure.
How good is that?
I think it's...
But when I talk about the creators, this is the extremities to where people go to. There are more people dying from extreme selfies and shark attacks. And look at this, man. This is the second tallest building in Hong Kong. We've got people, say goodbye to your donut. We have people climbing to the top of these buildings to try and find the most amazing way to express themselves. Because it turns out that personal expression is the new form of entertainment. And just when you think you've figured out where to put your brand, there's more and more places for you to think about. And that's the challenge, guys. There's more and more places for you to think about. So you have to rationalize where you get the deepest, most authentic place to do. But here's the problem. Today, we're in a world that's open. Yes, yes, yes. And you are judged upon popularity. Awesome. But here's the real issue. When I speak to young adults, they're locking their network down. And if you think about it, that closed network is an interconnected peer-to-peer network of human connections. And the challenge is, you're not allowed in there. Because what we think is an open book is becoming a closed book. Quick show of hands, who's on Instagram? Keep your hands up if it's set to private. And we're in the industry, so just think about that. So before we go, We have to think that there's been a surge of insecurity. So think about empathy versus sympathy. So what are you doing to stand alongside people and co-create together? But remember this, if you obey all the rules, you miss all the fun. And that's the reason why we became creative. So go out there, produce amazing stuff, and enjoy the rest of your DMEX. Thanks very much, guys. See ya.